carrying on the conversations from the morning session, it's extremely vital to have a session that looks at globalization, culture and labor, because globalization has brought in multiple ways in which labor gets integrated or completely mystified, however contributing to the globalized economy. Women have been very interestingly embedded within the overall global labor chain in various ways. And interestingly, it's women's labor, both productive and reproductive labor, that got inserted into it. And countries like India and many other, as I said, countries like India have actually reorganized their cultural beliefs, practices and also expectations from women. And we often say that when women are restricted from working in the public domain after sunset, with the onset of or with the setting up of ICT and ITES companies, several of which require English educated, English speaking young women to work as workers in these companies, either as call center women or as actually who contribute huge value to these organizations. We often say the gap between a call center girl and a call girl is actually very thin, because both of them occupy the same night. But how do they actually negotiate respectability? How do their families actually provide for and accept their public domain participation? All these are very interesting areas in which we find that families and societies and communities have reorganized. Nevertheless, they continue to reinforce several patriarchal ways of controlling women and their sexuality. So in this session, we have four presenters. The first presenter is Dr. Praveen Sinha, to my extreme left. Dr. Praveen Sinha is a political economist, and he's currently an emeritus professor at the Center for Labor Studies, School of Management and Labor, TISS Mumbai. Then we have Dr. Mani Nekalai, who is again to my extreme right. She's presently director and professor Faculty of Department of Economics, Bharatidasan University, and earlier she was the Director of Center for Women's Studies. To my right, I have Dr. Silky Ernst. She is Gender Equality Officer of University of Kessel. She ensures gender equality in faculty recruitment and student placement. And to my left, I have Dr. Vijayavajanta Anand, who is an Associate Professor at the College of Social Work, Nirmala Niketan. And she's a founder member of Nirman, which is a construction workers union. So we will go ahead in the same order. So Dr. Praveen Sinha will make his presentation on securing women workers' rights at the workplace. So since the PPT is going to be behind our back, we may have to do a bit of surface, either move away from here or turn around.
Let me endorse and acknowledge the work done by Professor Nivruti and Nandita in getting all of us here. Huge crowd. It definitely shows the quantum of interest that all of us have on the subject of the conference. Of course, at this time of the year, then prayers are everywhere. And many of us who live in Delhi, in a dry land, always have this fear of taking boat from airport to this place. And I also have the same fear. Okay, India is not a country which is new to the subject of globalization. 300 years of colonization by Britain, and earlier by invaders, and even earlier. So we are recipient of both economic exploitation, non-exploitation, and cultural invasion of people from outside. But let me limit to the period starting from let's say, the British period, where the focus was more on economic economics and also the trade. And such cultural aspect was not as prominent in the policy formulation of that period. So consequently, when India became as an entity in 1947, we had a semblance of what was trade during the British time. But insofar as the culture was there, it was not as prominently projected. And as such, over 200 or 2,000 cultural variation in the country, 1,500 languages, all this complicated the situation that we live in. All of us have different definition of the roles that men or women perform or expected to perform, in spite of the fact there is no confusion with regard to biological men and biological women. So let me concentrate on the role play and how, in the field of labor where I have been engaged all these years, has impacted the supply and demand situation of labor, genderization of work, and how the women workforce have been treated in an environment which is peculiar insofar the world social system is concerned. South Asia is one region, nowhere in the world, where you have on one side highest executive power being occupied by women, whether you take Bangladesh, you take Pakistan, you take India, you take Sri Lanka, except of course Nepal. And maybe in few years to come, maybe we will have a women prime minister or president in Nepal as well. So you have on one side women occupying the highest position, but on the majority, on the other side, majority of women are somehow pushed into the periphery of economic and the social system. And as such, you find that the policy formulation, the policy implementation, and what I heard this morning also, the enforcer of the policy somehow remain biased to the needs and expectations of women, in spite of the fact that the constitution is well defined. Constitution of India does not make distinction between men and women, and the laws made thereunder are more or less neutral. It's only later on 2008 that we had the first law, and 2013 we had the law relating to the specific to the women's protection following the Nirbhaya case. What I'll do is that we look at the situation as such. We know that India is the largest democracy, where we, the people, decide who governs us and in what way we govern. And if you look at the men-women divide, these are 50% women and 50% men, more or less. 49-50% more, insofar as numbers are concerned. But when you look at their position in the labor market, you find that almost 44% are reluctant to enter in the labor market. Maybe social compulsions, maybe family compulsion or whatever. 44% are not in the labor market. 24% are willing to enter the labor market, but they don't have the right job or they don't have a place to go. And only about 27% are actually in the labor market, which is the lowest anywhere in the world. So one side, we say that we are the largest democracy, where both men and women through franchise decide that who governs us and what policies are made. And on the other side, we are one country where we have the dubious distinction of the lowest number of women in the labor market. look at the gender gap, and if they are compared with Nepal, both in this region, and you find that India is a huge gender gap. On the other hand, Nepal is the lowest gender gap. And the women participation in Nepal is almost 80%, while in the case of India is 23 to 27%. This figure also relates to the issue with regard to informal sector, which has been highly emphasized in the first session, where we find that the women are concentrated in the low skilled informal sector, paid or unpaid, and it is in this sector we find that the laws that have been enacted are somehow not either effectively implemented or they are not there at all. And as such, you find that majority of the women who are in this sector are faced with the highest level of exploitation and exclusion. In the formal sector, a small section of women workforce is in the informal sector, but then there is some genderization of job that was again mentioned in the morning session, that you find them concentrated in the healthcare sector, in the banking and services, and I acknowledge the presence of my colleague Anjali Baker here. I think maybe in the course of the day she will present the case. And then IT sector and the other sector, you find that there is a heavy concentration of the women. As we move to the technical side, automobile sector and the other sector, you find that either the supply of required labor is not there, or there is general biasness of employer insofar engaging women workers in such occupations. Let's talk about paid and unpaid work at work. And you find that when you look at the various surveys that is done, and that is one I came across recently, that in the case of South Asia, we find that the majority of the unpaid work is done by the women, whether you look at Pakistan, Nepal, Bangladesh, or other countries. That majority of the work is of the women is for the unpaid worker, unrecognized work. And then the men spend very small time insofar unpaid work is concerned, and it is said that almost 0.9%. When I was looking at this thing, this diagram, I since I work for a right issue, I rather look at the unpaid worker rather than unpaid work, because there I find that there is some confusion with regard to which could be considered as a part of unpaid work of both men and women, and which cannot be included. Another factor that comes in before us when we look at the gender issue is that India, in spite of being the largest democracy and main economic and policy player nowadays or recent, is one of the most dangerous country to work in so far the women is concerned. And this is not only this recent survey by one research group, Thompson Ritter from Ghana, but also by International Confederation of Trade Union. They also said that India is one country where labor rights are violated in the largest manner, probably because over 93% of the workforce are concentrated in the informal sector, where rights are almost non-existent. We come to the current situation. On one side, we say that the education level of children are increasing. We have a large number of women workforce, women entering into the education line and getting educated. But insofar the workforce is concerned, their share continues to be 27%. And as we go more on skill side jobs, CEO and others, their percentage reduces to the level of 2.4%. Gender gap, if you look at the international comparison, India is poorly placed at 108th position, although in so far politics is concerned, it is on the 15th position, quite decent. Wage disparity continues to be there, although it is less than what it was. The women are far less paid than the men for doing the same job for the same hours of work, and the workplace is becoming increasingly threatening. And we have a number of cases. The case of Nirbhaya was only decided a couple of days back. But even before that, Soumya case from Delhi, who was killed. And then there are other cases, the Bangalore case, where one girl was raped and killed. The techie employees in Bangalore was killed. So you have a situation where the whole environment is rather biased and anti-woman. And then why it is biased and anti-women? Because I felt that there is a power gap in between women and men, especially at the place of work. In my work as a functionary involved in the labor issue, we concentrated more on increasing the power of the women at the workplace. And in doing so, we looked at these four or five components of women empowerment, that they should have right of self-worthness, they should have sense of self-worthness, they should be right to right of choice, not only determining, but also to have a choice. Then access to resources, and blah, 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 5 points. And then I go to specific examples. I don't go to case studies, but I go to specific examples where we look at women concentrated organizations and women where they are occupied, whether we look at the informal sector or the formal sector. And we find that through consistent input, we were able to reach certain stage of success, very slow, but there was success in so far, whether we look at the forestry workers, domestic workers, street vendors, whether we take the mode of income generating scheme or right-based scheme, and also the self-help group. 3 points that came, second last. 3 points came very evidently in my work with whether I look at the cooperative, whether we look at the self-help group, or we look at the trade unions. There is general biasness, whether you look at a democratic organization as a trade union or cooperative, or look at the government itself. Look at Anganwadi, look at what you call teachers, friendly teachers, or what teachers they call it. Idea is to not to bring them into the category of workmen. The moment they come into the category of workmen, they become eligible for all the laws. And as such, they find various new definitions. The government itself find new definition of defining whether it's a teacher or a Anganwadi worker and so forth, or a health worker. So finally, there are 3 suggestions. On the figures that I quoted, or many of the figures that we try to use in trying to understand gender issue and the women issue, these are made by an organization where somebody said that it's a male psyche is there, and that psyche comes in the results and in collection of data also. So, first and foremost is that there is need for have a primary survey done for and by women, so that we have women issues specifically seen from the women perspective, not from presumably woman perspective. The second factor I suggested that they need to identify organizer or functionary who understand and empathize with the issue where women are concerned and the proper skills are given. And final statement is that let's take the effective learning process where we have, or teaching process where we have learning and unlearning, where both gender needs to present. The men need to unlearn the practices, and the women need to understand and unlearn the one perspective. Thank you very much.
The topic I'll be presenting is the outcome of the two projects. One is already completed, the other is on. And I also fully agree with my colleagues already presented that this unpaid work is the subsidy that is being paid to the paid economy. Both Ritu and Indra are very much emphasizing that. And the work which I will be presenting is in between this paid and unpaid worker. That is something I can call it as underpaid. So taking the young women workers there in the textile and garment sector, what are the kind of issues that they face, and what has to be done, that is a kind of a thing. And next to agriculture sector, I know you all agree that the textile and garment sector employs the largest labor. And recently, for the past one decade or so, the textile and particularly I'm talking about the Tamil Nadu context, where you have the export processing zone located in the five or six districts, including Tirupur, Coimbatore, Karur, Erode, Madurai, Dindigul, etc. So the first study was conducted to understand the issues of the adolescent girls who were employed, who were drawn from the rural villages, in remote villages, where there is a desperate need for a livelihood. Already there is a failure of monsoon, and therefore they driven to other cities in search of employment. So poverty was the first major driving force, and the men are also earning, but still that is not sufficient, or they migrate outside, and therefore the people who are left include both men, women and the young girls. And of course, they don't believe much in education of the girls, and therefore they better, and also other considerations, the safety, after the puberty, the girls, the parents do not, have the safety of the women there, the young girls. So the poverty, the loss of livelihood in villages, and the absence of earning members, other earning members, and most of the earnings of this wage class go also to alcoholic consumption, and that is also another factor. And sometimes in some of the households, I'm only presenting the qualitative, I'm not going to the empirical findings because it will take a long time, so I'm just confining to that. And in some households, it would be like marriage expenses, or these medical expenses would also force the girls. So ultimately, it is the forced labor that the girls take up to this employment directly. And another thing is that it's not really dowry, it is like you have to meet your marriage expenses. For that also, the very word I'll be explaining, that what is that smuggly, that the girls are being taken to that market. And this is called either camp labor scheme or smuggly scheme. Earlier it was smuggly scheme, and later there were public hearing and state was intervening and to regularize this. Ultimately we couldn't get it removed, but really regularizing in certain components. And therefore this now is called as camp labor scheme. And basically this smuggly scheme is that girls will be drawn, there will be agents appointed in different villages. They will take care of identifying the potential girls, potential quote unquote. They will be able to come and stay for 3 years in a company, and the lump sum will be given. Historically speaking, it started like giving gifts. When some girls or women are employed, the parties were paying some gifts in terms of kind, whether it is a furniture or jewelry or utensils, like it is an uncle's gift. That is what it started. Later on it became a, it has come out as a market where some decade back, it was paid in jewelry also, some 5 sovereigns of gold plus some amount like 30,000, 35,000. Now gold has gone up, price has gone up, and therefore they are only paying money. So once you get entered there, there will be agreement that you will have to sign, and I think you may know the insurance paper and other things. Similar will be this paper also. Nobody will be able to read and what is the content of the paper, etc. The parents who are not much literate, they will be signing the paper. They may not be knowing what is actually there in the paper. So that is what it start. The people come here, the girls start coming there. And after completion of 3 years, it will be given a lump sum amount of 35,000 to 50,000. And how it does get approved is also like they don't understand the dynamics. Like the minimum wage is not paid, whatever the wage is fixed also, they draw some amount, and that is only going and agreeing after 3 years they will be paying this amount. Even this is not informed to the laborers. And most of the girls, in our study it was revealed that even 9-year-old girls were found. And you inflate the age, the factories just show in records that they will be 14 and above, because most of the girls are not really gaining the state or enjoy the status of a labor, but as my apprentice or trainees. And therefore, this is what I told already. So there were 140 samples there in the earlier study that was completed, and another study where the girls were redeemed by the respective NGOs working in those areas, and what is the role, what is the status now? That is what I try to say in the given 15 minutes. And of course, the very term Sumangali itself literally referred to the married woman. Yeah. So you have captured that term Sumangali to attract the girls to come and work, and they will be getting some money, go back and get their meet their expenses, either the marital expenses or whatever it may be. So it is gender, that is what I say. The market and capitalism reinforce the marriage to girls. There is no choice that the girls can also stay single or choose the other. But still, and some of the, I already told that some of the NGOs, they have also working to improve the welfare of these girls, redeeming them, taking them to higher studies, and they offer skill training. So some of the foreign NGOs, funding agencies cover these NGOs, offer support to these NGOs, and they are able to redeem these girls. That is happening in certain context, Coimbatore, Tirupur areas. And the second part was conducted in hill areas like Nilgiris, Valparai, and Coimbatore. The other thing were in other districts. In fact, when I collected the data for the project, we had to go there in festive days. Only 4 or 5 days is to be given as leave for these girls during festive, Deepavali or Pongal. And we were there very much in those days to collect the information, because we can't go to the factories and collect such information. And so the issues, of course, it is very common, and it is also applicable. And I already told you that it is underpaid, and most of the majority, 90% of the girls are from dalit, the tribal and poverty households. So socially and economically backward communities are being captured there. And I told you, it's a modern bonded slavery kind of a system. And long hours of overtime is being given, but you are not accounting for that. That is very important. When there is no information as to how this overtime charge, work extracted from these girls or women are accounted for, they are just given only the monthly wage. And no minimum wage is being practiced, and they can't form unions. And poor working conditions in terms of facilities, the toilets. In one of the companies, there are around 100 employees, but only one toilet. So really ill maintained, and you are not, once you use it, you will get all such of infections. So similarly, working conditions, night shifts also, and there is no safety, and the huge issue is sexual harassment. I'll be spending some time there also. And there are some positives also, because when you stay there in the village, there is no employment, and therefore this particular tech sector is really catering to the needs of the employment, livelihood, etc. And food security is ensured, because whatever the food you get, 3 square a meal day. And but the living atmosphere is not much highly ventilated. We ourselves physically visited them also, and we stayed there. In some companies, they allowed us to visit and stay. And They also get many such health issues, just normally related to the allergy, because they are working with this cotton-based thing and everything. I already told there is no legal labor status. When you reach 18 only, you will be able to. So they give in the records, either you inflate the age and show that they are laborers, or they will be under apprentices. In that context, you will be denying the rights, labor rights, whatever the social security thing is to be paid. And entertainment, see, this is one of the attractive measures they are given with TV and other radio things. And within the hostel premises, you can also learn something. This is not found in all the factories, but in some of the factories, which we visited in a different context, not for collecting the data. And why these women and young girls are preferred, because of these reasons, which is very common, not forming union. They don't question any violations or not be questioned. They just oblige whatever is being asked by the respective managers or the supervisors. Two more minutes. Okay. Then, so this is what I already told, how it is being deducted, no minimum wage. And the other facilities were given, and there is no privacy. When the call comes once in a week, you are permitted to talk, and there is no privacy. The loudspeaker will be on, and whatever is to be conveyed also, whatever you suffer also, you can't do that. And this is very important. So sexual harassment is all pervasive. It was also emphasized on most all the speakers, and I don't know how it is going to be like very universal in every factories or working context. And several of them, they don't report, and even if we ask also, they don't disclose. And there are now unions and women-based organizations, trade unions, etc. They are working to address this issue, but still it is also, I'm sorry to say, how capitalism is working. Like they are very concerned, very much concerned with the kind of restrictions that the hostel, you are not supposed to go out, you can't talk to anybody, and even the parental calls also will be monitored, etc. But at the same time, they don't have any concern over the kind of issues and harassment that the working context, where so right from the co-worker to supervisors to others, they used to do molestation, sexual favors, etc. It is not actually taken care of. So that is what they just see that the work is being delivered, and whatever the kind of work atmosphere that the girls suffer doesn't get reported at all. And the very smuggling scheme signifies that it is marriage related, the girls to go for marriage, etc. Now there's girls who are working, or after completion they return, and they are not preferred by the guys. If the girl is from cotton mills or spinning mills, we are not preferring these girls. That is what it is. And the other point, what is actually being done, etc., and what is to be done by the end. We'll finish in 1 minute. So these are the things that are either done by the people who are working for that, and basically it is NGOs and some trade unions also. If we speak, I've been discussing there, and the evening also the round table, I'll be working, maybe sharing all these things. Some developments are taking place. It's not that nothing is going on, but still whatever the under current that are providing are not really working. So what we need actually is a social campaigning which is to be effective. Just in certain corners it is working, not other corners. This is the other part of the study I told. So these are the issues they redeemed, but they told that these are the issues they faced, and health issues also. So this is the way forward. So I have summarized already that there is some forum they have to have, particularly the NGOs are helping, and such NGOs are only working in certain pockets. It may have to be universalized. And the multi-stakeholders initiative is required, and all the stakeholders concerned must come together, both the government and non-government. And the very weak state is that this Labour Commissioner Office itself or the Child Welfare Committee itself not much concerned with the issues that the girls face. So that is also needed, the convergence of all the departments to work together is needed. Thank you.
And my presentation focuses on my experiences at the University of Kassel in Germany. I'd also like to mention that I was socialized in the field of natural sciences. I'm a geographer and climatologist, and that's why one of my focuses is on women in STEM fields, means science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Let's have a look at the University of Kassel first. It's a young university with 25,000 students in 140 study programs. It covers a wide range of fields from STEM, the humanities, social sciences, and arts. The mission statement of the university stresses the particular obligation to ensure access to education regardless of gender, nationality, social, or ethnic background. Well, this is the leaky pipeline, you might know, at the University of Kassel. And it shows the percentage of women which decreases with increasing academic level. You see the light yellow line at the bottom. Undergrad students at the very left side and graduates are close to equal distribution on the average across all studies, with a slightly higher share of women graduating. Amongst the PhD graduates, we observe 40% women, and the share of women declines to 29% for all professors. We can also see a positive development comparing the years 2008 and 2017. The 8 is with the dots, and the straight line is the line from 2017. And the share of female PhD graduates has gone up from 30 to 40%, and the share of female professors has also gone up in a little bit slower way from 22 to 29%. The comparison of Kassel University with the average of all German universities is shown in this slide. And it reveals that in Kassel, the share of female PhD graduates is a bit below the German average, whereas the share of female professors is above the German average. So we are quite on the average in Kassel, in that concern. Compared to other European countries, the amount of full professors in Germany is well below the average. Germany, the red bar, lies on the fourth of the last position before the Netherlands, Lithuania, and the Czech Republic. And these data are from the SHE figures report that is released by the European Commission every 3 years. Women and men, and we have heard that already in the presentation before, tend to concentrate in certain scientific fields. These are the data from all the German universities. Whilst women are more likely to be found in fields like social sciences and humanities, men are more likely to study, teach, and do research in fields related to engineering and technology. In 2016, more than 40% of male undergraduate students in German higher education are in engineering subjects, compared to 12% of the female students. These are big blue fields in these two bars. While women are underrepresented in technical fields, men are underrepresented in the humanities. Stereotypical subject choice, and this refers to the gender knowledge which has been presented by Professor Scherer. This stereotypical subject choice of students is therefore a real concern in gender equality policies. The gender equality policy, when we look at the structure. The horizontal segregation, which has talked about, can be observed in all European countries, and this is the European basis, but to a very extent. the share of women in mathematics, statistics, and science is around 40%. This is the gray bar, the several gray bars you can see. In engineering, women are underrepresented in all countries, as well as in information and communication technologies, where only in Sweden there is more than 20% female students. This is on the very right side, the Swedish data. Women remain severely underrepresented within the subfield of computing, and this seems to be slightly different from the situation here in what I heard from the presentation before. I want to summarize this bit. Academic career remains markedly characterized by a strong vertical and horizontal segregation, even if there are important differences across European countries. The result is that viewpoints, experiences, and needs of half of the population risk to be overlooked or dismissed. Now I want to look in more detail at the working conditions in academia, at the gender, and at the gender equality policies at Kassel University. When we look at the structure of the staff at Kassel University, we see that men depicted in the blue color, light and darker blue, they are more likely to be employed as researchers, whereas women depicted in red color are more likely to be employed as administrative and technical staff. What we also see from this figure is that a small percentage of researchers is working in a permanent position of a professorship, and the great majority of research is being performed on a fixed terms contracts and on third-party funding, which is also a fixed-term contract. When we look in more detail at the gender distribution, we see that women are more likely to work on a fixed-term contract, and they are also more likely to work part-time. Women do work a lot in part-time in Germany, and they do this at university, not always due to their own choice. They mainly work in scientific fields, where lower income and part-time contracts for PhD students are widespread. In engineering, full-time contracts are very common. The gender equality policy at Kassel University is influenced by national and international gender policies and by German law. I selected a few of these fundings. The European Union objectives for gender equality in research are, first, fostering equality in scientific careers, second, ensuring gender balance in decision-making processes and bodies, and third, integrating the gender dimension in research and innovation content, the gender studies. On a national level, the German Research Foundation has integrated gender equality as part of the selection processes for research funding and offers additional money for gender equality measures. This initiative turned out to be an effective measure to strengthen the university's gender equality policies and to involve more women scientists in the research projects. A university ranking based on gender equality criteria is being published by the Center of Excellence Women in Science since 2005, and this also helped to raise commitment in universities. In 2008, the German Ministry of Education and Research and the federal states launched the program, the program for women professors, supporting 500 additional women professors. In Germany, the equal rights laws of the federal states oblige higher education institutions to appoint gender equality officers like I'm one and to implement action plans for equal opportunities. Well, this slide shows you the actors and governance structure in gender equalities at Kassel University, and the responsibility is in the presidential board. Gender equality is implemented as a cross-cutting issue, and many bodies like the Commission on Gender Equality and Diversity are involved. The Central Gender Equality Office holds instruments like the family welcome and dual career service. We offer qualification and mentoring for female students and scientists, monitoring and consulting. The faculties are supported to govern gender equality on their own and orientate their measures according to the faculty culture and also according to the objectives of the whole university. And I believe that this understanding of the cultures and of the structures and processes is a key to gender equality. I'll give you a very short, and this is nearly my last slide, overview of the gender equality measures of the University of Kassel. We have mentoring programs, we do active recruitment of women professors. We had the implementation of a research group, Gender and Diversity in Informatics Systems, in 2017, in order to introduce perspectives from gender and diversity studies to computing and to enhance innovation and inclusiveness. We offer coaching for newly appointed professors. We offer diversity training and qualification to prevent sexual harassment and work-life balance measures. I come to my conclusions. In German higher education, strategies for gender equality tend to focus on institutional and structural change. It is increasingly acknowledged that gender equality and gender analysis contribute to the quality of research and innovation. There is awareness in the scientific community that gender balance in research, teams, careers, and in decision making is fundamental for inclusive societies. And still, there is much room for improvement. Thank you.
Lakshmi. But I want to congratulate actually Nandita and Vibhuti and the entire team for organizing such a great international conference, because the paid and unpaid work is something which is, you know, which one cannot neglect or ignore. And I've been listening to some of the papers, and I feel that, you know, what I am presenting contributes in, you know, getting a better understanding of where women are. We have been, you know, we cannot now talk of labor unless and until we talk about informal sector or informal economy as such, because we know that 93% of the labor force is in the, you know, informal sector. So whenever I've been listening to a lot of debates where they are talking about dwindling number of women in the formal sector, but when that presentation happens, the focus is that, you know, oh, what is happening to women? They are not in workforce, but they are there. They are in the workforce, but where are they? Why are we not able to see them? And what exactly is their contribution is something which all of us have to grapple, and that is where is the dark, you know, danger zone which I feel we need to focus on. You know, so when we are looking at the Indian labor market, what we need to look at is that after the globalization or economic, you know, liberation, there is a fragmentation, and fragmentation of industries, disintegration and breaking it into pieces, and the ability to think that, you know, we can draw labor force from any country, anywhere, don't even call them labor, get the work done at the, you know, basic minimal level, and still say that, you know, we are growing economy, or, you know, it's okay to do all this. So fragmentation is something which we have to look at, and also, you know, that is the reason why the size of informal labor market is growing. It is growing so much that, you know, one cannot just ignore it, but at the same time, one has to look at that in what way are they contributing to the GDP, to the formal economy, what are the links. And one of the things which I want to talk about is, you know, I'll be skipping some of the, you know, slides, because these are some of the things which all of us know. Or, you know, whenever we talk about home-based work, we talk about two types of home-based work. Actually, we are talking about home-based workers who work on piece rate basis. Who are these home-based workers? They are sitting at home doing some or the other kind of work, and they are paid on the basis of the amount of work they do or the pieces which they do. Okay? There are roughly around 8.9 million home-based workers in India. This is 2004-2005. I'm sure the number has increased. And over 50% of the women who work informally outside the agriculture sector work from home. So home-based workers' relative isolation reduces their bargaining power and their opportunities to learn new skills. This is one point which I want all of you to pay attention to, because my intensive work in construction industry as well as small scale industries in Dharavi shows that most of the skills which are in the informal sector are traditionally handed down skills, and that means it is completely a glass ceiling for women. Women never learn any of the skills because there is nobody to teach them those skills, because they are men dominated skills. So what is the reserve for women is to take up work which is termed as unskilled, which they are pushed to take up because there is no alternative. So when we lull ourselves into thinking that women are taking up home based work because they are sitting at home and work is coming to their doorstep, so what is wrong? That's not the issue. The issue is she would rather come into the labor market and take up the work, but work is not available to her because she is not skilled. She is not skilled because there is nobody willing to teach her all those skills, because those skills are traditional or it is in the informal domain of education and not available to her. So what happens here is that she is working from home, meaning her home becomes her workplace, where she provides the space, she provides the lighting and the arrangement. Many times she contributes to the raw material in some way or the other, and all that is her own contribution, and what she gets paid against is something which is really, really very surprising. This is again some figures which we have to look at. One can look at it in the sense that formal sector doesn't outsource it, and that's how it comes to the doorstep of the woman who is sitting at home. How does she get the work is something which we need to look at once again. Decent work, we keep talking about this, and I always, when I teach it and students ask, but where are they, these decent work standards? And I always wonder where exactly are they, because we talk about employment opportunities, we talk about legal rights, social protection and representative voice. All of this is missing when we are talking about women working from home. And I'll focus more on the study which was, this is also, again, as I said, there are two types of home-based work. One is where she is an entrepreneur, so she produces, it's her capital, and she is basically selling the product in the market, but she is sitting at home and doing all this work. And the second one is subcontractual work, which she takes up as a job work. Somebody comes and gives her work at home and she is getting paid against it. So I am concentrating on the second kind of work, that is the subcontract home based work. Okay. I'll straight away go to the case study, because that speaks for you. This is again some information on women in subcontractual piece rate work. This case study is actually a collaborative work between me and one of my students. We took up this work in Mahul, which is in Chembur. It comprises of slum pockets, various kinds of slum pockets. We took up three slum pockets, okay? And based on our understanding, this is, and with my experience in various other slums, this is representative of most of the slums. I have seen the same thing in Dharavi, Dahisar, in Ambujwadi, in many other slum pockets, but this is a representative. And this is concrete case study. That's why I thought that we don't talk about figures which we can't touch. These are the people who we have met and who have been able to talk to us. So around 50 women were involved in this study. What is the kind of work they were doing?
you know, soft toys. I'm giving a description of the kind of work they do, because many times we feel, oh, ghar par baith ke, you know, she's sitting at home and doing something. It's, even you ask them, they will say time pass. You know, I'm just sitting at home doing something, otherwise I'm just whiling away my time. But it involves so much of intricate work. And still, why do we call it as unskilled or no work at all? Or work which deserves minuscule amount of payment. This is again, you know, the papad making, putting beads into the threads, zari work. Look at the intricacies of the kind of work involved in this. And women call it unskilled work. Now, this is the table, you know, I wanted you all to look at. Look at the amount of money they make. You know, this is the piece, like, you know, 100 bracelets. Each bracelet consisting of either 30 beads or 16 beads, you get 10 rupees for that. You saw the amount of skills which are involved in it. Look at the sticking bindis or sticking diamonds. Okay, look at the amount. 14 rupees. Again, 100 hair clips, 14 rupees. 44 diamonds, 2 rupees. And 171 shapes, you know, this is something called diamonds on the shape. You know, you have to put diamonds, 150 rupees. Okay? Each one of that is done throughout the day. And once they keep doing it, because each one takes little time. You know, look at the, you know, making soft toys. One piece of soft toy. This is one woman who demonstrated. She is just given pieces of all these sponges and things like that. She has to turn it into this soft toy, cuddly big soft toys which we see in the malls. And take home, probably we pay 400, 500, 600 rupees. Per soft toy takes almost 2 to 3 hours to assemble. There is no design given to her. There is nobody who trains her. She has to figure out, she has to stitch it, and per piece she gets just 6 rupees. Okay? So, one piece of soft, you know, soft toy bag, she gets 7 rupees. Look at the amount which she is getting against the kind of work she does. Just compute it in terms of, if we want to say that it should be equivalent to 8 hours of work and minimum wages. So if we are saying minimum wages is 250 or 260 rupees or 300 per day, 8 hours of work, whatever she does, any of these things, even if she does it for 12 hours a day, it will never be equivalent to minimum wages. It's just not possible to be equivalent to minimum wages. Okay? So what I'm trying to you know, bring it to your notice is that in this, where does she get the work from? Somebody somewhere comes and gives the work. She doesn't know who the person is. That's the agent who comes and gives the work. One of the most exploitative part of this is, one is the money is so less. And when you ask her, why do you actually do it? Is it really time pass? Then why are you spending, you know, 10 hours, 12 hours, 15 hours in completing the work? You realize that many of the households are dependent only on her income. It is not a time pass. It is not a side kind of work. This is the mainstream economy of that family. And what is very important to you know, talk about in this is the feudal nature of relationship between the employer and the employee. Meaning that this woman does not have a right to ask the money up front, ki maine ek soft toy banaya, give me 6 rupees just now. What she does is she keeps taking little credit from this person, and against that he keeps giving work. She is lulled into this thinking that whenever she wants credit, this agent will provide the money. She has no clue how much of work she has put in, where is the account, where all that is recorded. She believes completely on the agent, and many times lots of money has been lost because she is continuously in this debt cycle. And the agent keeps telling her that, you know, ye to loan ka amount tha. So every time you need, I'm giving you money. So there are no records maintained in terms of what kind of work was done and against that, what kind of money she has earned. So what is she looking at herself as? A non-worker, but still running the household on her income, and in a feudal relationship where she has no voice at all because there is no one to speak on her behalf. She is not even in demand in the market. Is she not in demand in market? She is very much, because agents seek these women out who can do this kind of work. No, who are willing to do this kind of work. And the families feel that it's all right because she takes care of children, she takes care of household work. But we see these women bending and doing continuously this kind of work, sometimes sacrificing their children's education because everybody has to contribute if money is required. You know, sometimes the doctor, somebody, neighbors, everybody sits and does this work if she needs money urgently. Okay? So this is the conclusion, the last slide, where I want to say that, you know, the subcontractual home-based work seems to be growing sector. It's not reducing, it's increasing. There are number of things which are coming into the gamut. I have instances where women are, paid not on the basis of the product. They are like, you know, gunny bag of cloths, you know, shredded cloths which she sorts out, and later on they are converted into wipes. Okay, she may not be paid on the kind of wipes she has produced, she's paid on the gunny bag or the sorting. So somehow turning whatever she does as completely unskilled, not required kind of thing, does not figure anywhere in our GDP, in our work, but she's continuously engaged in it, and we need to look at this. And we need to somehow connect the dots why she is into this kind of work, and when are we going to talk about these women and connect it to 8 hours of labor, which we had actually fought for all of us, and which we always, you know, celebrate and say that 8 hours of work, minimum wages, and recognition as a labor force. So, you know, the feudal nature of work, and this is happening blatantly everywhere in and around us, and somewhere none of us are trying to understand that piece rate work is taken over even below the minimum wage level, which, you know, which we are fighting for. So this is below that. So even if you want to bring it to the minimum wages level, I think there is going to be a big struggle, because this is completely invisible kind of work, yet very much visible in and around us. So trade unions, all of us, you know, women who have been fighting, this is one area where Seva has focused. We need to all of us focus and figure out how to bring all these women into labor force, recognized as labor force, so that they get minimum wages and they can proudly say we are laborers, not just sitting at home and doing time pass work. Thank you.
So I've been told by the organizers that they actually have no time for any Q&A. That much of the, most of the ideas that we have, most of the papers and the ideas that are coming through these papers is going to be very much part of the discussion in these 2 days, and we'll be able to carry forward our discussions and debates. The 4 presentations that we had, one was a macro presentation by Professor Sinha, and 2 presentations by Mani Nikolai and Rajit, basically are the papers based on studies that they have done with informal sector workers and unorganized sector workers. A lot of the findings are like so, monotonously repetitive. From the time 1988 we had the Shram Shakti report, we've been talking exactly the same things, whether it's to do with recognition of these women as workers or getting them identity cards or making sure that they have insurance policies and schemes or thinking through a kind of cess which actually provides for all women who work, so on and so forth. And I think those conversations have been in suspension for a long time, and in this conference I think we are bringing back those issues again. The presentation from our friend from Germany basically tells us the organizational good practices in terms of working on gender equality, and I think very few institutions in India are attempting something like this, and we have a long way to go. And I'm sure most of us here will take this idea back to see how we can institutionalize these best practices in our own institutions. Thank you very much, and organizers, please take over. Thank you. Thank you, Chairperson. Thank you, Deputy. We would have Advanced Center of Women's Studies, which is part of School of Development Studies in TISS, Mumbai. Thank you, Dr. Meena Gopal.
So I sort of come in place of Dr. Madhura Swaminathan, who was earlier supposed to chair the session, but nevertheless, we have a panel of three speakers, and without much ado, this session will focus on the paid and unpaid work of women in rural and urban areas, and I'm sure all of our speakers are going to bring the intersections and the connections between rural and urban existence and what it means to be in various diverse sectors, and I hope we can have a short conversation after that. So I will briefly introduce the speakers in the order that they will present. So Shomita, you would go first, and then Jyoti, and then so Professor Shomita Sen is at present Dean, Faculty of Interdisciplinary Studies, Law and Management at Jadavpur University. Significantly, her monograph on women and employment in the jute industry in the colonial Bengal, which was a very significant publication, it won the Trevor Rees Prize in Commonwealth History. So, welcome, Shomita. Jyoti Mapsikar is one of the founding members of Sri Mukti Sangatna, an NGO that works in Mumbai. Currently, the organization has mobilized more than 3,000 waste pickers in Mumbai and is part of the Alliance of Indian Waste Pickers, a national organization. Sri Mukti Sangatna has also helped in the construction of biogas plants, training members in securing zero waste contracts for maintenance of sanitation routine and maintenance of biogas plants. Professor Anuradha Banerjee is from the Center for the Study of Regional Development at JNU, Delhi. And she's a adjunct professor at the Indian Institute of Dalit Studies. She's also the vice president of the Indian National Cartographic
Association. I was the president of the Indian National Cartographic Association, and I was the GSS chairperson in the JNU for 2 years.
So Professor Banerjee's name was correction. So thank you very much, and I would request now Professor Shomita Sen to. So we can have about...
One with all the speakers of the morning, let me also thank Vibhuti and Nandita for putting together this fabulous conference for us. To just say one word on that, I think that we have a renewal of interest in paid and unpaid work after almost 2 decades. Of not talking very much about it, and I think that is a very interesting turn that scholarship has taken. Let me give you 2 caveats. One is that I will not do rural and urban, and I'm looking at domestic work as in an urban context. I think I will speak to the diversification rather than the rural and urban. The second caveat is that I will diverge very horribly from the abstract that I've given you and which is in the book. And the reason for that will be clear to you in a minute or two. I begin by talking about a contradiction. There are many contradictions within the gender and labor space at the moment. But one major contradiction, and I draw this from Meera's presentation in the first session, is women's relationship to the process of unionization. On one hand, you have something like the Munnar plantation example, where women in traditionally in central trade unions are challenging leadership in those unions that are moving away, wanting to establish their own unions with their own strategies, and they're looking at both alternative ways of associating as well as alternative ways of doing politics. At the same time, you have women who have traditionally been excluded from formal processes of unionization, who are now seeking to enter it. And the domestic workers are a very good example of this, because in the context from where I come, in Calcutta, they were told for many years that why do you want to do unions, do societies, do associations, do other forms of collectivities, but they did not. They wanted to form unions. But for many decades that domestic workers wanted to form unions, central trade unions didn't want to include them. As late as 2011-12, we have public statements by trade union leaders from many trade unions, not one, saying that domestic workers are not productive workers and therefore not proper subjects for unionization. So this is a slightly complicated space. In early 2018, when I wrote my abstract, this was the situation in West Bengal. There was one registered trade union, which was registered in 2010. And there were another number of unions that were formed but were not receiving registration. They had applied for registration, but the registrations were not received. There were other kinds of organizations, and I won't read out the names for you. Some people who are members of some of these organizations are there in this conference, and I'm sure they will tell you more about it in their presentations. For me, what is important is number one. And this is why. In May 2018, they did receive the registration. So the abstract I wrote was about why in Calcutta domestic workers unions were not receiving registration. So now that they have received one union has received registration, the story changes somewhat. So there has been a lot of celebration because it has been a long wait, as you can see, from 2010 to when the union received registration in 2010. And later on, when another application came in 2012-13, and the state government refused that registration, and they were asked, and I was there when we asked the Labour Department officers, why? What is your problem? If you've given one, then why can't you give others? Their argument was that it was a mistake. They gave the 2010 registration by mistake, and to correct that mistake, they were then refusing all other trade unions the registration. Now, this became a series of arguments, and it is only in the past year that the momentum has increased and there has been increasing pressure from organizations for this registration. But throughout this period, and I've been to many of these meetings, throughout this period, every effort to tell these organizations do something other than a union has failed. They have stuck to their guns that they want a union. So this is the organization that has received the registration. This is roughly their profile. The response from trade union leaders to this event, to their receiving the registration, so Dola Sen, who I had interviewed in 2012, and who at that time had been very positive, already the president of INTTUC, was very positive, but even she had failed to convince her own government and the Labour Department to give the registration. Her main response was that they did not have a domestic workers association union but wanted to build one. Situ gave roughly the same response, which is very peculiar because EDWA has a domestic workers union or association, Shomiti they call it, it's not exactly a union. But obviously the Situ is either not owning the Shomiti formed by EDWA or their, you know, I don't know the status of the AIDWA group. INTUC, whom we have been in conversation for a long time, has for the last 3 years been talking about a union of domestic workers, but none has yet been formed. Now, this relationship has been a change, a remarkable change from 2011-12. And there is now increasing interest, the antennas have gone up, central trade unions are now alert to organization happening in this sector. Now, the first domestic work legislation for domestic workers was mooted in the 1950s. Many people don't know this. And then it went into cold storage. It was revived in the 1990s. And from the 1990s, in the past 20 years, there have been many bills by various agencies. And none of these, except there have been a few legislation that are state-based legislations, but by and large, this idea of a national, at one time there's a platform, then there's an act, none of this has actually come into being. In 2014, there was a moment before the elections when it seemed as though the UPA government would pass that bill, but then it bombed, it didn't happen. And now it's indefinitely postponed. Now, historically, women have been marginal to central trade unions. In other work, which I'm not going to elaborate here, I make an equation between unionization, formalization, and masculinization. The tide turned, this triad, changed, started transforming from the 1990s. Which is the moment of liberalization, which is in many ways in the history of unionization a tragic moment, because it is the beginning of a challenge to threat to unionization. But it is also a moment, every crisis is an opportunity. So it was also an opportunity for unionization to redefine itself. And one of the ways in which unionization sought redefinition was to move away from this complete overlap with formalization and to explore informal sector. Now, so what then, if you look at the background, if you look at West Bengal, then West Bengal, which has a very long history of unionization, one of the most militant unionization, is also the state in which you have had a decimation of industry. And this has meant a shrinking constitution for central trade unions. So for central trade unions, what is most important is to expand their constituency. And domestic workers, as the last speaker in the previous session spoke about this, the invisible women. But invisible but numerous, hugely numerous, and so invisible that we don't know the numbers. So there is, you know, there are totally wild estimates of how many domestic workers we have in this country. There are official statistics, but people associated with the sector argue that these statistics are huge underestimations. Whatever it is, it's a very attractive constituency. In this context, remember that in 2013-14, the C2 for the first time declared that women were outnumbering men as within the C2 as members. And this was why? This was because they had just begun to organize Anganwadi workers, the scheme workers who were wholly women. It is because they moved into that fresh constituency that their numbers expanded, but this expansion meant a complete change in the gender composition of that union.
So this is the direction in which this expansion of trade unions will happen is, yeah, is an interesting question, but domestic workers are a very important part of that. Now, in the West Bengal context, and this is very interesting, that it is West Bengal which has had a 34-year left front government led by the CPM, but CETO in West Bengal has not taken these initiatives. There is no organization of scheme workers in West Bengal. However, what the CETO has not been entirely neglectful of the informal sector. It has organized some informal sector workers. And the work that I have done is the auto rickshaw drivers, which is one of the most signal successes of the CETO in organizing informal sector workers. It is obviously 100% male occupation, but at its height, the CETO had 75% membership of the entire auto rickshaw driver population in Calcutta. That's a huge unionization, and it was an extremely powerful union, and auto rickshaw drivers could paralyze Calcutta at the drop of a hat. And in a sense, this is another highly contradictory story. A sector that is the most informal because it's virtually paralegal. Why is it paralegal? Auto rickshaws actually do not exist in India. There is no such thing as a three-wheeled vehicle in the Motor Vehicles Act of India. And yet 75% of the world's auto rickshaws are in India. So you have these bizarre things. So this paralegal sector has the most powerful union in West Bengal, led by the union of the ruling party, which is the CETO. So it is interesting that when CETO organizes informal sector, it organizes a profession that is wholly male, but is hugely hesitant to organize domestic workers, which is a profession that is almost wholly female. In this context, I would point out that another layer of contradiction is that what then intervenes in the market what intervenes in the space is the market. So what you get is market innovations. And one form this market innovation has taken is brokerage agencies. This is familiar to most people, I'm sure, in their personal lives in the city of Mumbai and in many other major cities of India. I'm not going to read out that slide, but there are all these various tendencies that are visible. And I would put this in the context of a trend in the informal sector that has become noticeable in the last 20 years, which is a slow process of formalization of the informal sector. However, it is not a formalization that follows the trajectory of the earlier formalization of the late 30s and early 40s, or late 40s and early 50s. It is a very different kind of formalization, and scholars have grappled with how to express this. So Kundu and Mohanan call this informal informalization. Rico Jyoti Bondopadhyay has called it uninformalization. And the politics of this informal sector has also, this changing informal sector, has also been the subject of major theoretical interventions. We can trace the beginning of that with Partha Chatterjee's political society, but more recently Rina Agarwala's intervention is very, very significant. So this Meera had flagged as a movement from labor to citizenship. And I think that is actually one of the major developments which we have to keep an eye on.
in this context then of a different kind of innovation, a different kind of intervention as opposed to collectivization, political collectivization, I will bring you back to the care diamond that Ritu Devan talked about and show you my most favorite image of domestic workers and diamonds. Illness, absolutely wonderful. So yeah, so my last sentence will be on the, when we finished in the morning and we talked about alternative macroeconomics and alternative microeconomics, I would say we need alternative economics, and I would say that talking about this image, I would say that we need, for instance, an economics that understands marriage. You cannot understand the woman worker if you don't understand marriage. So we need capacious enough economy disciplines which are not, so you to understand the woman worker, you actually, as the dowry in many ways, as Mani Mekalai pointed out, is the economic is the transaction that symbolizes the economic character of marriage. And it is by looking at issues outside our mainstream discipline that we can think of alternative.
It looks at in a municipal corporation, people or police, they look at her as nuisance. And why they do waste picking? Because they don't have any other skills. Most of them are illiterate. When we started working 20 years ago, we found that even their daughters were illiterate. They were taking out them from school because there was nobody to look after other children. So they used to take them out at age of 12, and then either they will get them married or they will do all household chores. So no fixed hours. I don't know whether how many of you have seen waste pickers, but she will, as we have described, she has a sack, so she will take it on the head or her shoulder, and till she gets whatever she wants that day, that particular day, she will collect the waste, and then when it is very difficult for her to carry that, then the nearest middleman, she will sell it. So how much she can carry? So maybe around 30 kilo or 40 kilo of weight every day. That's why there are so many health problems. And when we started working, we found that there are no documents, because they were even used to deliver at home. So no birth certificates for children. As they had come from drought-prone area, they did not have any papers. And it was very difficult to organize waste pickers. And major problems for them was the storage and transport, because they are carrying their garbage on their own shoulders and or heads, and nobody will allow them to get into a rickshaw, taxi, bus or whatever transport modes are available. And they are also exploited by the middlemen, as she has said about the agent who are exploiting home-based workers. Similarly, waste pickers also go to the middlemen, and they sell their whatever rate he offers. They sell him, and they. Another thing what happens is that after she sells the garbage, what happens is that whenever she wants some money, as there were no bank accounts, she used to take the money from him only, and he will never keep accounts. And she will always be giving him only, that was the trap, of course, death trap, where she will be trapped continuously. And that's why she didn't want, supposedly asked her that you go to the other man who is giving you better rates. She won't go there because she has already taken money from him. And he gives me money, that was her, because she used to feel that he is the one who is a money lender, and she is safe there. So you must see what is the pyramid of waste. So, if you see, the best speakers are always at the bottom. And the first shopkeeper who is there, whom we sell our waste, newspapers. Because even if you are having rupees 1 lakh as income at home, you will sell your newspapers. Nobody will give it to the waste picker or someone. So then there are waste sorters. Then there are waste traders. Because some traders will collect only white paper, or somebody will get only brown paper, newspapers or plastic. There are different types. Only PET bottles or only PVC. So there are different waste traders who sell ultimately to wholesalers and then to the recyclers. You see, the waste pickers are always at the bottom. And if we come to this side of India, there are almost 75% women are there as waste pickers. If you go to the other side, Delhi and all that side, there are all men who are waste pickers. Now you will see that waste pickers at the bottom are all Dalits. The first shopkeeper will be a general shopkeeper. The middleman waste sort of 2-3 and wholesalers are all Muslims. And the recyclers are, again, all the factories are in Gujarat. As I am talking about Maharashtra, so most of the factories are in Gujarat. That's why now this plastic ban has come. So the Maharashtra minister said there won't be any unemployment in Maharashtra because factories are in Gujarat. So unemployment comes, it will go to Gujarat only. But again, you will see that the women are only work as best speakers. And other whole business is handled by men. So why waste pickers work is important? Because otherwise, now people are, after Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, and especially in Maharashtra, when there is a plastic ban and there is a fine, the people have started segregating. Otherwise, those who are champion of environment and all never segregate at home. So actually, you have to segregate at source. So what is the contribution of waste? Because the city is the reduction in waste handling. Because if you just imagine that dry waste which is collected by them, maybe it is 10%, 15% of total waste. Imagine the transport cost of that. Because in city like Mumbai, there are crores of rupees have been spent on transport itself. Then of course they supply raw material to recycling factories. This role is always forgotten, that they supply raw material. Then also they save space at dumping ground. Yeah. So but if the waste is segregated, you see the housewife also starts selling. As long as it is dirty, nobody bothers about the waste. Moment it is clean, everybody wants to sell it. So housewife, house assistant, society sweeper, watchman, municipal worker, and then again waste picker is at the bottom. So, of course, as she is exposed to toxic material, toxic waste, she is always sick. And what we want is a decentralized, low-cost, energy-efficient, labor-friendly, high-resource recovery, environmentally sound and sustainable waste management. But however, this doesn't happen. So what we started doing is to... we started training waste pickers. I mean, even if you just go around Tata Institute of Social Sciences, you'll see that we have a biogas plant here. We are training women in composting, so that if you give value addition to their work, then they can get better jobs, whatever we call now green jobs. So there is an opportunity there, and we don't, women are not ready to leave this profession, because there is an instant money. You collect waste up till afternoon and then sell it in the evening and you get the money. Even if you offer them job, they say that you give us daily wages. Then only we will work. And those wages are not, you know, whatever wages they get. After 1990s, as our income increased, our garbage also increased. One must remember this. So we started giving them training, and then we also initiated their cooperatives and their federations. So this institutionalization helped them to get contracts on their own. So we have these cooperatives and federations. Then we helped them to secure work contracts. Earlier nobody was giving them any contract, but after 3-4 years negotiating with the institutions, they started getting contracts. There are no social security schemes for waste picker. There is, though in Swachh Bharat scheme it is written that it is compulsory for municipal corporations to give them identity cards and integrate them, but no municipality is doing that. Now they are, you know, in the survey form, you must be seeing those boards, Swachh Sarvekshan. So in that now they are given marks, 25 marks, if the waste pickers are given identity cards. But still, municipalities are very reluctant, I think. And though they are below poverty line, still what are government schemes are there. Usually they are not even registered, you know, in any government scheme. So now we are asking municipal corporation to give them drive-in centers or step shops so that they can have their own scrap shops and they can sell their own waste. So they can become a middleman. So I think I can stop here because there are many things still we have to do. And we have an Alliance of Indian Waste Pickers, that is organization which has around members from 30 cities. And I have to also say that they are all negotiating with the government, but it is very difficult because unless until the municipality gives you I-card, you cannot take advantage of any scheme. So when that will be done, then only the waste pickers will get. And whether, I don't think that waste picker should remain waste picker. We are seeing, we have a very large education program where we are seeing to it that their children don't become waste pickers. But unless and until they get a full-time job, because they don't have any other skills, it is very difficult for them to survive. And only one last point I will make, that if the cities become clean, waste pickers will be really jobless. Because there won't be any waste which will be thrown on the road. So you have to give them alternate skills, and citizens have to segregate and give it to them directly, the dry waste, so that they become collectors and not the pickers from the roadside. Thank you.
Thanks to Professor Vibhuti and Dr. Nandita for giving me this opportunity to come and share some of my ideas. In a research project which I was working with the Indian Institute of Dalit Studies sometimes back in 2013, and some of the findings, not entirely because it was a big project, so I plan to share with you today. And good afternoon everyone. In this difficult time, I'm standing in between lunch and you, I know that. This is Nature and Forms of Discrimination Experienced by Dalit Women in Urban Labor Market in Delhi. Before I go to how we conducted this study and how we went through this, basic idea what this study is about. This study has tried to take cognizance of the multiple layers of discrimination that is still existing in our society in order to capture the problems of Dalit women, particularly in the low-income sector. And the social discrimination that I'm going to talk about today of Dalit women, it transcends class differentiations and all other forms of differentiations, and these problems are compounded, and that is primarily arising out of Dalit identity, and all other factors are also interlinked with it, and the outcomes are very disastrous. So at the onset, I would like to say that there are overt barriers to access in the urban labor market, that is access to labor, with what I'm talking about. And there are a host of background variables which are shaping this, be it poverty, be it poor education, gender discrimination, caste, and many, many other issues that we are talking about.
getting manifested in the form of very few years of schooling, very high rate of dropouts among Dalit women. This is, of course, women from low income categories are also the same, and the low quality of education. And as a result, what happens? It leads to low skill formation or low levels of acquired training or no training at all. And as a result, nil work experience. So all of these have complex ramifications, and which gets translated into them. And because the work becomes now necessity driven and push driven, so there is forced entry into poor income jobs. More than their choice, it is a forced entry, I reinstate. And then there are on-job problems, which are because of the lopsided decision of labor, even within the same profession, physical segmentation of the labor market, women working under constraints of binding decision of the male members, discriminations in earning, disadvantages in combining household chores and other jobs, and getting a job through informal sources, which is another very, very pressing problem. And this results, ultimately results in low bargaining power, issue of constrained choice and limited contacts, residual labor participation, restricting skill formation and upward mobility. So all these get manifested into dead-end jobs of a dead-end variety. So there are on-job problems. And of course, on top of that, the outcome is the compounded problem of the Dalit women, which is an expression of the multi-layered deprivation. And therefore, there is a negative outcome on many fronts, be it in their earnings, be it in their health, including maternal health, be it in their dignity, and the basic integrity as a human being. So, and many of them are exposed to indecent behavior at the workplace. Now, so to sum up, the context in which we have been working is limited access to work, discrimination at workplace. It can be a factor of many things, gender or caste, class marginalization, patriarchy, and the list is numerous. And ultimately, it hinders women's access to education and skill formation, and results in a low-paid income. And at the backdrop, we have other set of factors, which are liberalization, globalization, increased informalization, rural-urban migration have increased over a period of time. And women are found in the lowest section of the income hierarchy. So there is a gender configuration. We have already noticed that and discussed about that. And Dalit women therefore constitute the lowest rung of the entire endemic process. So here what happens is even in this dead-end jobs, hiring is influenced not by merit but by other factors. And moreover, the jobs are basically characterized by irregularity in wage payment, uncertainty in job tenure, lack of leaves, there is no leave, no medical cover, during ill health and pregnancies. And on top of that, the lack of legal protection that many of my predecessors has been talking about makes them absolutely vulnerable to a lot of problems, including verbal abuses, sexual and physical abuses. So in this context, all these factors result in multiple vulnerabilities of the Dalit women. And though there are certain factors which are common to the processes are common for all women in the same socioeconomic setup, but some of these factors often transgresses other women in the same socioeconomic category. So with this, the basic objectives, what we had tried to do was to trace the background factors or the barriers that is acting against the access into the urban labor market, that is why they are basically forced into take up tail-end jobs, then to examine the nature of problems, exclusion and discrimination faced by Dalit women in comparison to women, other women in three types of jobs,
though I will not be able to discuss all the three today because of the time constraint, this is household jobs as domestic maids, sweepers and cleaners, sanitation workers, and other self-employed women who have very set up small establishments. So today I'll be taking up only the domestic maids because of the time constraint. To study the nature of discrimination itself, so discrimination can be manifested in various ways. One is complete denial, and then if included, what we call inclusion with differential behavior. So the second one is talking about, if included, discrimination in type of work, discrimination in wage earnings, and behavior at workplace. I will just skip the research hypothesis. I'll go into data and methods. Mixed method approach, and basically more inclined towards field-based evidences. We had tried to pick, make a macro level picture, carve out a macro level picture taking NSSO rounds. And basically the study takes up primary sources based on structured questionnaire, collection of experiences on both self-reporting as well as inferential observations, focus group discussions, and particularly an audit study. Audit after Younger, we had tried to introduce in this study also by interviewing the placement agencies over the telephone. The basic purpose to do the audit study was to capture the act of discrimination, to catch the discriminators in the act of discrimination. This is also based on a the methodology introduced by Younger sometimes back. So the CiRiC findings, I'll come to that. The nature and forms of deprivations, as we had noticed, the vulnerabilities and the discriminations, though they varied across all the three subtypes of low-paid, dead-end jobs that we had selected for our purpose, but there were certain features which were common to both. And the common features are like deplorable conditions of their settlements, because most of them were located in very, very poorly environmentally fragile zones, which are mostly the slums and the sweaters all over Delhi, and which had an implication on their health. So it's not only health at workplace, but it is also health as part of the residence that matters. Large family size, poverty, debt burden, and mostly from informal sources. So that means that they go into a vicious cycle of debt, and coming out of it, breaking and coming out of it is a Herculean challenge. Then uncertainty of work and fluctuating income, occupational shifts, low levels of literacy, awareness, and poor health outcomes. And the caste factor was found to be overriding, and Dalit women were found to have faced discrimination of a higher order if we compare the other caste groups, that's the OBC and the general. And this was at the household level, at the work sphere, as well as in social life. Now, of all the categories that we have taken for investigation, the highest discrimination was found among sweepers and cleaners. And my predecessor just talked about rag pickers, who are entirely Dalit women in Delhi. They are basically belonging to the Balmiki community. They have often reported harsh behavior and other kind of on-job problems. And the indifference by the employers about their problems. So this is the highest reportings we had got under this category. Then among the self-employed Dalit women, various forms of discrimination have also been noticed, particularly from the people who are the raw material providers as well as the clients. And then there were other problems associated with community, social life, etc. And more importantly, what was very striking is that these women, they have this caste factor, and that they're Dalits, strongly entrenched into themselves. That the perceived discrimination factor was very, very salient. So I won't go into this. These are some of the secondary data findings, where proportion of informal workers, all of us know, very high in Delhi, and the self-employed category, urban females. The study area, this project was spread over most of Delhi, because we try to pick up samples from, give it a wide base so that no part of Delhi is left out. And mostly the settlements were the mixed settlements, that is the slum locales and slum pockets, because the children jobs are mostly located in this. So I come to my case study. Some of my findings I want to show before I wind up. So one can see that, again, the caste factor is very strong. And the, sorry, these are the general issues which I won't go into detail, because working in as domestics is really a very, very tough job. And since they are again multitasking, they are bifurcating the familial responsibilities with that of the work, where they are working. So I'm not going into detail, but I come to the main findings now. The method employed, as I had already told, it's a telephonic audit survey, is one of the methods in this. This is on the placement agencies who are providing domestic maids. 25 such placement agencies were contacted, and their telephone number was taken over from the newspapers, Hindustan Times and Times of India. And there were two auditors who were posted as potential employers of domestic maids, had made telephone calls to find out the ground truth of these workers. So first, I come to complete exclusion. The first category is complete exclusion. Self-reporting, about 15% reported that they were excluded because of their caste background. And the placement agencies also reported that they required the demand domestic help which were from the upper caste. And so what they do basically, because they also have a service area from which they collect or gather these maids and recruit them, hire them and give them work. So they also reported that they often change the name, that means they hide the caste identity before supplying to the clients. And some population groups were noticed that they absolutely, the caste factor is very strongly entrenched in them, that if it's from a Dalit background, they won't hire a person. And elderly people, they are elderly in the family, they basically were against it. So this is some of the excerpts. I won't read through it, but I would like to reinstate again that this excerpt is about a girl who hides her name because of continuous rejection and disappointment which she had received. What she says is no fault of hers. Because the general concept goes that Balmikis should be restricted to deal with garbage cleaning and cleaning of toilets, not to do with other domestic jobs, and certainly not for cooking. Then the second comes, that was, the first was outright discrimination, the second was discrimination at place of work, where we find that cooking is not usually given to people who are from either Dalit background or people who are not belonging to general background. And scheduled caste women reported that they are not hired for cooking. So what happens basically is, on one hand, even they, if they have the knack of cooking, they're not getting the job, their talents also go unrecognized. So this is again the workplace discrimination which I'm talking about, and this is discrimination in wage earnings, as one can see across various categories and across various caste groups, there is discrimination. So there are some times that they are not even allowed to use the ordinary vessels, or they have that they cannot sit with other people, and a lot many other such problems. So they can enter the kitchen but not wash the clean the refrigerators. So this is a case study again at the interface of gender, class and caste, and the problems are deep rooted. It is not only at the work site, it is not in access or work site. This case talks about, it starts right from the parental home. So it talks about that. So I come to the summary. So the problem of Dalit women is the interface of gender, poverty, caste and all other such factors. So first is complete denial for domestic work, as we have seen evidence of placement agencies. Then discrimination in hiring, that they hide their identity, either they hide their identity, they get low pay wages for the same work others are doing. Thirdly, sometimes they travel quite a bit of distance so that no one gets to know that they are from the Dalit background. Then discrimination in type of domestic work, discrimination in wage earnings, as we have already seen, and discriminatory behavior at the workplace. So the role of caste in hiring for domestic work and for the other categories, which I cannot explain at the moment, is a very less explored area of research and it needs deeper understanding. So all sort of suggestions which emanate from these studies, it needs a liaisoning between the government sector, non-government sector, and to address their problem, and basically emanating out of the unregulated nature of the jobs which my predecessors have been speaking about. So I needn't go into that detail. With that, thank you everyone.
Thanks, Arati. And please, per institution, college, university, NGO, take one copy. There are limited copies. Our volunteers will come and give. So if the delegation of 5 or 3 members, take one, only one person, take for the library.
For all the 3 months, I think. Yeah, we can keep the claps going. Couple of announcements before we move for the parallel sessions. We now have the parallel sessions and
Desai. Professor Manisha Desai is the head of the Sociology Department and Professor of Sociology and Asian and American Studies at the University of Connecticut in the US. Professor Manisha Desai, we welcome you to chair the session and I also request you to introduce our discussants for the session. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Tanshi.
So good afternoon, everyone. I'm sure this is a difficult time after lunch, so if you fall asleep, we'll understand that we'll try and keep you awake with the interesting information that we're going to share with you. So I'd first like to, our other discussants also arrived. I'll first introduce the papers that Professor Sarla Rav is going to discuss, and introduce Professor Rav as well, and then I think we'll take a break because we have enough time. Because several of our presenters were not able to make it today, so we actually have enough time for discussion. So even though we are half an hour late, I think we should all have plenty of time. So our first presenter is going to be Deepmala Bagel. She's from the National Law University at Nagpur, and her paper is titled Social Framework Analyses of Organizational Role Stress Among Working Women in India. Our second presenter is going to be Dr. Chainika Singh, and she is from Kolkata, a psychologist and an author. And her paper is titled Self-Confidence of Professional Women and Their Business Bloom. Our third presenter is going to be Diana Thomas on professionalism, gender. The discussants for those three papers will be Professor Sarla Raj. She's Associate Professor in Center for Human Resource Management and Labor Relations School of Management and Labor Studies here at Tata Institute. So, let's get started.
Today, we all here gather to understand women in paid and unpaid labor. My paper is towards the smaller contribution towards that bigger understanding of how women are into a labor framework. Basically, this paper is actually my contribution towards understanding once you break that glass ceiling and enters into the labor force, what happens? Because since long, women,
their organization at individual level, at collective level, they are fighting to break that glass ceiling. But in today's scenario, when we have entered into the labor force, as from our participation also, we can very well recognize that how women, working women, become day by day, it is becoming more prominent. Though there are paradoxes and there are contradictions that I am going to discuss with it, but at the first premises, we have somewhat, though at little level, but we have broken that glass ceiling and we have entered into almost every field of the known unknown working area, labor field. So, when we enter into that labor field, what happens with the women's life, what happens with women as an individual, is the interest of my paper. It is a social framework analysis of organizational role stress among working women in India. Before again going into detail, I just want to give you the basic brief about from where this has begun. During my PhD, when I was doing the innovation, social dimensions of innovation in small scale Ayurvedic manufacturing industries, and I interacted with various entrepreneurs from micro, small to the large scale industries. Then I also gone into the various service providers, beauty parlors, spa owners, various different types of. During that meeting, I also interviewed the professional women. When interacting with them, one thing that constantly coming up was that they all suffer from certain kinds of stress, but the stressor means that the cause for that stress differs according to women to women, according to their profession. So I realized during that process that, okay, collectively we all say that this is a woman, working women, non-working women. So working women suffers from certain kinds of stress in their life because of their overwork, because of juggling between the two spheres. But when I was interviewing these women, I came to realize that, okay, at collective level they all suffered, that is a different parameter to understand, but we need to go beyond that. We need to understand the requirements of each profession or each at least social context, because according to the social context, the stressors are different, the causes are different, and the result also differs according to the social context in which they are. So from there, this social framework analysis has emerged to understand the organizational role stress among the working women. So this is the structure of presentation, the brief introduction, then conceptual briefing, methodology, discussion and conclusion. I will skip if time doesn't permit. So, introduction. As I already began my introduction, so here I will come on the focus of this paper, actually the paradox. Women in the home, housewife, or women just at the home. This one scenario. Another scenario is the working women or women at the workplace. We, in today's time, we are living in this reality that women can found at home, can found at that, she is found at both the places. But there is a paradox. Paradox, why paradox? Because culturally, women are still recognized as a prime caregiver in the family. It is their prime job. So when we think about the working woman, then this her prime job or her prime importance at home and now newly acquired her role at the working place, it gets at the contradictory position, and because of that, the working women often faces the various stresses. This is the one of the paradox. One thing in terms of Indian economy is that the female work participation has been increasing. It has increasing at certain level, in certain sections, in certain sectors, that is okay. But I will come to that. Before that, how the labor force participation has been women percentage point since 1980s up to the 2011, it has shown a growth trend. But this is the one side of the coin. At another side, in recent year, the study is also showing that women's work participation ratio has been declining. And one of the major reasons that came for this is the role stress among women. And it also found that in these studies that when attaining the certain level in their employment, in their career, after that also many women left the job because of the familial responsibilities. During the specific time period of their life, there are different reasons to leave the job, but collectively if you look at that, it is actually the contradiction that happens between their familial role responsibilities and their working responsibilities. So often when these contradictions appear and they are at that juncture to decide or to take up one or to take one sphere, they often choose the family first. So this is again the second paradox that we are in it, where the working women as a number though shows the increasing rate, there is also a paradox where the women are leaving their jobs, and the prime reason is about that mental stress or that stress that generates because of their role at the family level and at the working place level. So here the basic thing that we need to understand is there is a multidimensional nature of women employment. Multidimensional, it means because of our cultural, because of our social understanding of women in society, we cannot take gender neutral approach towards their work. This is the first understanding of my research. And the second is that the impact is much wider. It is not only the individual who is suffering, but because individual at that level, he, she is suffering, it has its repercussions in family level as well as that organizational level where she is working. And combinedly, if we look at this, it is the loss of the society at large. Like in morning, Professor Indira Sahar says that how creation of the human capital is a very important need in today's time, and state cannot be just the overlooker of it, and it is not the solo responsibility of the family. Within this context also we can say that how the human capital generation taking care of the family, taking care of the members of the family, culturally recognized as a women's job, has been now in a that contradiction where working women and women at home, the scenario in which she is right now. So we need to take the different mechanism, different framework within which we can understand the women's role, and accordingly we require that kind of mechanism to understand if women is at working place, what is her status. So these are the objectives of my paper: to study the role stress among working women, to examine the unique role stressor for particular profession, and to explore the impact of role stress on women's health, work and family. For this paper, I have not gone into the primary work. Here I have given the presented only about the what literature is saying, and from there I have just derived some hypothesis and tried to understand the scenario, specifically the women and their this both role struggle. So if we try to understand the concept that I have used in this paper, I will not go into much detail of it. Stress usually studied a mechanism to deal with your environment. There are psychological studies basically done in this area. But here in this paper, what I have been trying to say that, okay, stress though it generates at individual level, but as that particular individual is embedded in the social context, much of the role stress that I am dealing with is the generator from that social context. It is not only about that particular individual, but that individual is embedded within a cultural and traditional and social setting of our land. So, organizational stress in simple term is the stress that is generated in an organizational setting. My basic interest in this paper is that role, understanding the role. What is the role? It is actually in sociological terms, status and role is a very important concept to understand the individual's standing in society. Status is a position that society gives you. You are standing there, your position is your status. And according to your status, there are responsibilities attached to that status, there are the rules and regulation of behavior, and that duties that are attached to that status. that duties, responsibility is the role you are performing in your life. Role set is the number of roles that is attached to a single status. Role space is that the individual self and its surrounded roles, how that interaction happens. That's the role space within which that individual works. Here it will be more clear what is the role stress. In today's scenario where multiple roles are there associated with the multiple status, women, she is a mother, she is a wife, housewife, these are her statuses. Working employee is another status. Accordingly, she has her responsibilities to perform. So that's the multiple statuses and multiple roles. When there is a conflict that arises between these two statuses and accordingly the two roles, she finds herself in that stressful situation. See, this contradiction or conflict between the two multiple statuses and multiple roles are not the simple that there are a work overload or there are too much of roles are there she needs to perform, so that's why there is a conflicting situation. This is not that simple one-on-one relationship. There are multiple factors as well which plays a very important role. So organizational role stress has been studied by the Bharat. This is a scale that has been used by many of the studies, and I have also taken this as a parameter to understand the dimensions associated with the role stress. That the simple term we used to take it that because she have to juggle between the two spheres, that's why there is a stress. This simple term has a multi-dimension attached to it, and when we try to understand this role stress through various parameters, these are the various dimensions through which the stress generates. These are the role ambiguity, personal inadequacy, role overload, role isolation, resource inadequacy. These are the various dimensions through which a particular woman or particular working woman suffers because of the various reasons. When there is no clear-cut understanding of what to do according to their given duties, role ambiguity emerges. Role overload is a very well concept. We all, in general also, we used to say that, okay, she has to juggle between two spheres, so that's why there is a work overload. But we never think about that because of the role erosion also, there is a stress develop. What is a role erosion means? When you are able to do the duty, but you are not given that duty only because you are a female. So, that erosion of your role has been, because your status is an employee, so you have to give that duty. You have that kind of expectations from that role, but you are not being given only because you are a female gender. So this is the various kinds of stressors that contribute for the role stress among working women. Then these are the basic proposition, basic understanding from the literature, where I try to understand the role stress among various working women. They engage in various professions. According to their professions, when we look at in detail, in minutely, we find that not all role stressors are experienced by the women in different professions. Specifically, the professions like teaching profession, which is well accepted by the society as a female-oriented profession. Doctors, again, nurses, same. These professions which are termed as a more feminine profession, there the role stressors are different. There women don't find to be in a conflicting situations. That's why there is, we find the less inter-role conflict or self-role distance or role ambiguity. These where the clarity is more in terms of why this clarity is there, because society accept them there. So this acceptance part, they don't need to work hard, or they don't need to pay attention towards proving themselves in terms of that 5 minutes.